McBain. It's Diane McBain, is it?
Yes.
How are you?
I'm well,
Diane McBain, Glendale, you grew up in California.
I grew up here from the time I was four.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, I went
to Glendale High School?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's where it all began for acting career. Someone spotted
that's
you in
right.
a play or something?
That's right. I was doing a little play at the Glendale Center Theater.
Uh-huh.
And Sally Biano, who was a casting executive at Warner Brothers, came over to see it.
Uh-huh.
And he went back with great news to Jack Warner and said, I found her, I found her.
Is that what he did?
Something like
yeah.
that.
They used to, the studio heads sent people out, casting people out, and mm-hmm. looking for stars.
They still
starlets.
Do.
So you were discovered by Jack Warner's casting director, huh?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
So mm-hmm. what happened? Then they signed you up? Did you have to do a screen
yeah.
test or what?
No, hardly. I mean, it was really fascinating because they had this picture called Ice Palace that they wanted to do.
Richard Burton.
Yeah, Richard Burton. And they were looking for the granddaughter, and they had me come in for a meeting with Vincent Sherman, who was the director.
Right.
He tested me, but he didn't ask me to act in the test. He just wanted to see what I looked like on screen. So they
uh-huh.
just did this sort of, you know, physical, you know,
uh-huh.
test.
Right.
And they signed me to this contract.
Immediately, without acting.
They didn't even know if I could act or not.
Uh-huh.
I mean, that's ridiculous.
But they had ideas those days,
well,
didn't they Diane?
Knew,
look
they
back.
Knew what they were doing. They knew what they were
the
doing.
Studio heads had ideas.
Yeah, yeah.
See,
they
could train you mm-hmm. as the picture goes along.
Mm-hmm. They did.
Is that right?
That's exactly what they did.
Yes,
yeah.
Which they don't have today. See?
No.
Yeah.
No.
Diane McBain, working with Richard Burton.
Yes.
Nervous at the time? You were,
I didn't even know who he was.
Oh, really?
No,
I
didn't.
How old were you then? 18?
I was 18.
Uh-huh.
I was such a baby, and uh-huh. I was from Glendale, and I mean, I knew nothing.
Uh-huh.
I was so fresh. And I met him.
That's the way to be. Yeah.
Well, it was, yeah. But, yeah. you know, when I met Burton, I just went, you know.
Carolyn Jones. Robert yeah. Ryan.
Right.
Robert Ryan.
Yeah.
What a great actress.
Oh, yeah, all of them were wonderful.
And what did you learn from this movie? What did Diane McBain learn while you were doing this film? You must have learned a lot, Diane.
Well, I learned a lot, but the one thing I remember was that I had to keep control of my voice. Because at the time, of course, without any experience,
right.
as soon as you get into an emotional scene, your voice goes way up here, you know.
Uh-huh.
You know, and they said, hey.
Low it down. That's the first secret in films, right?
That's right. Yeah, you got to know how to do that.
Uh-huh.
So I learned that, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Did they sign you? And you went to school on the set of Warner Brothers? On the
No, I had just graduated from high school.
Uh-huh.
So I didn't have to go to school anymore.
So you
I was
went
18.
To school was right into the movies.
Yeah,
right?
Right into the movies, right? It was like going to college.
Uh-huh. How long did you work on the film?
Oh, I don't know, 3 months,
God,
something like that.
Working with those great actors. So.
Went to Alaska, which is the first
it was in Alaska.
Trip
yeah.
I ever went out of state. You
uh-huh.
know, was to Alaska.
Your parents? How about your parents?
My parents, yeah, they were still.
They were happy about this?
Well, no. No.
They didn't want you to get into
no,
business?
No, they were very worried.
Uh-huh.
They had heard all the bad stories, you know,
uh-huh.
and they thought, oh, no, she's going to do that. We wanted her to be a school teacher and a wife and a mother.
Oh, is that mm-hmm. what they want? Mm-hmm. How about you at the time?
Well, at the time, I sort of thought that was pretty okay. But then, you know, with all this wonderful stuff happening to me and
uh-huh.
Richard Burton and, I mean, hey, you know, I got turned around
uh-huh.
very easily.
When you went to the screen of the film,
mm-hmm.
Ice Palace, Diane McBain, first film, big movie. That was a,
that
big,
was a big
film.
Movie. Yeah.
When you went to the screening,
yeah.
do you remember the evening when you went to the screening of this great film and you see yourself
no.
on this screen?
I don't really remember that.
Come on, Diane.
I must have blanked it out. It must have been awful.
That was
it must have been a terrifying experience.
Because that movie was a big film. That was
it
a
was.
Long film, too. How long was that film? Was it a couple hours and a half?
Well, this was a three-generation thing, you
film.
Know.
Yes,
yeah,
yes.
Went through three generations
uh-huh.
of people.
Very, very good movie.
Very
I just
good.
Loved a movie. You went to Loretta Young's modeling school, too, before that.
Yeah.
Is that where you studied a model? You wanted to be
yeah,
a model
right.
and
well,
actress,
you know, I was a tomboy.
A tomboy.
I was a tomboy. I was a tree climber. And I loved to play baseball and all those things. So my mother said when I turned 15, well, we've got to do something. Or she's going to, you know, become something.
What happened at Warner's? When you signed at Warner's, there was another actor there, Troy Donahue. He was doing films there. You were with Troy at the time.
Yeah.
They were doing Parrish at the time?
I did Parrish with him, and then I did Surfside 6, was a television series about Florida and detectives.
Surfside 6 with Troy. You've done three movies with Troy Donahue.
Well, Surfside was one, and I did Parrish, and then I did A Distant Trumpet.
A Distant Trumpet.
Yeah.
But Parrish, what another good movie.
Yeah, that was
That was with Connie Stevens, Carl Malden.
Yes. And
Claudette That was her last.
That was her last film.
Claudette Colbert's last film.
Screen. Yeah, but she went back to the stage.
She did to the theater, but she never did films after this one. This was a great film. I love to show the clip of this movie, Parrish.
Well, you have it, don't you?
Yes, I have the film, and I want to show this clip. It's one of my favorite films, too.
Okay.
You've done two of my favorite films.
Oh, good.
This one and the Ice Palace.
Okay.
And I'd like to show this clip right now of Parrish.
Okay.
Are you my watchdog?
You're Allison. I'm Ellen McLean.
Yes, I know. My father wrote me about you. Where is he?
Well, he's out in the fields. We didn't expect you till dinner time.
Oh, put them right there, Fred. I averaged 80 most of the way. Only got one ticket. Trying to keep a date. Does my father expect you to manage me or just spy and report to headquarters?
Or possibly to help you? My first hope is that we might like and understand each other.
Well, then you might as well know I consider this place a living death. And no matter how hard he tries, he won't be able to ram it down my throat.
But it's perfectly beautiful.
And he can't hire anybody to do it. Shall we declare war, you and me?
You and I.
Allison, welcome home, baby. Well. let me look at you. My goodness. Now get down here in the light where I can really see you. You're a woman, darling. You went away a girl, you've come home a woman. This is my daughter.
Yes, we've met.
Mrs. McLean has planned a real gala dinner for you.
Oh, I'm sorry. I wish I'd known. Wiley called to say he's arranged a welcome home affair at the club for me tonight.
Wiley Rake? I thought you promised not to see the Rakes again, honey.
You'll have to get used to Pop and the Rakes feuding. He seems to think that Judd Rake virtually stole most of his land. Besides, the son drives a red Mercedes. I'm sorry about dinner, Daddy. Don't wait up for me.
When you see this film, when you see yourself on film nowadays, especially this clip, what does go through Diane McBain's mind? What does go through?
Well, a couple of things. First of all, the makeup was so thick.
Was it really? It was Max Factor, right?
Oh, yes. Incredible. In fact, I should do my nose.
right.
But the other thing that goes through my mind is that it's like a lifetime. I mean, it's not even this life. It's like it happened maybe, you know, thousands of years ago or something. It doesn't feel like me. I mean, it's like this other girl.
Did you have a good time doing this when
I
you
did.
Were
yeah.
enjoy you enjoyed doing it?
Yeah. I did. Oh, I enjoyed everything I did. Mm-hmm. It was an incredible time. I mean, they had the studio
18
system.
18 years old. The system.
18. Yeah. They
set
me
your dates.
In. They set my dates. They gave me my wardrobe. They dressed me in furs and diamonds. And they gave me all this publicity department stuff, you know, behind you, and they did everything. They trained you. Mm-hmm. They did everything.
Diane, I'm looking at you. Who was your first date in Hollywood? Set you up with.
Gosh,
you remember?
Probably Troy.
Troy Donahue?
Yeah, I think
was
it was
he?
Troy.
Was he?
Yeah, I think so. or Mac the Knife? Remember him?
Oh, yes. Bobby Darin.
Yes.
Did you do a movie with Bobby at all?
No, I never worked with Bobby.
I love Bobby. I knew him very well. I love Bobby Darin.
Yeah.
Troy Donahue, working with Troy.
Oh, I love Troy.
What makes you love Troy so much? He's simpatico, he's caring.
Yeah, very, very simpatico, I think, especially with women. He has a kind of sensitivity that a lot of men don't have.
Uh-huh.
With, you know, can rapport.
A
kind of rapport
yes.
with uh-huh. women that guys don't generally have.
Who's some of the rough actors you've worked with? Some of the real rough actors?
Rough?
Yeah. Is there some...
No.
Well, Robert Ryan, you know?
Well, Robert Ryan was... But he was a very gentle man.
He was?
Oh, yeah.
What did you learn from Richard Burton in that film, Ice Palace? Let's get back to that. What did you learn from him? Because he's such a great actor.
Well, he is a great actor.
Did he tell you... Did you?
He saved my job on this film.
Like what?
Well, I was very raw, very, very new.
Right.
And they got into production, and they realized, of course, that, you know, I had so little experience. And they were going to fire me.
They were going to fire you?
And he went in there, and he said, look, you know, she's got talent. You don't have to worry. I'll do something. And so he came back, and he worked with me.
He did work with me in
our scenes, and it came off all
right. So he gave you some pointers.
Yeah, he did. He did. I don't remember what they were. I'm sorry, Skippy. I wish I could remember those details.
Looking back, you said you had a good time, though.
Oh, it was great.
But you don't remember some of the things.
Well,
small
little things. No, I don't remember those details.
Uh-huh.
I suppose I should, because I'll have to write them someday.
Are you going to write a book?
Oh, I probably will, yeah.
Working at Warner Brothers Studio, you know, that's a big studio.
Yeah.
Let's face it, Humphrey Bogart.
Oh.
Betty Davis. They must have all been on the scenes there.
Some of the greats came out of Warner Brothers, but they weren't there
when you were there. No, you were there.
I came at the sort of tail end of the studio system.
Of the studio system.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Diane, looking back, you did Dallas also. You worked on Dallas. You've done Days of Our Lives. You've done a lot.
I've been around.
Well, you have. Distant Trumpet. Where was that filmed?
That was at Warner's.
At Warner's?
Well, we went to Kanab, Utah.
Uh-huh.
And that was the area where we...
Caretakers. Were. Tell me about the film, Caretakers.
Oh.
That was a good film.
Well, that was Joan Crawford.
Joan Crawford.
And Polly Bergen. And
right.
People like that. It was a film that had a lot of women in it.
Uh-huh.
And I learned how to work with women in this movie.
Like what? What do you mean?
Well, it was all very sort of backbiting and power
bitchy,
struggles.
Bitchy.
Very bitchy. Oh, I couldn't believe it.
But you played a lot of bitchy roles, though, Diane.
Well, I have, but I wasn't bitchy in that movie.
Not in this one. But you have done it at the beginning of your career.
Yeah, yeah.
Why did they give Diane McBain such bitchy roles at the beginning?
I don't know.
An innocent girl from Glendale.
I don't know. And I never could relate to these girls. But I always did a good job, I guess. And they thought, oh, well, she can do it. So we'll cast her that way.
Uh-huh.
And I got stereotyped in, you know, these sort of bitchy things. And
is Joan Crawford tough?
Oh,
oops, you're saying something. Come on.
Oh,
that expression just now. What does that mean? Come on.
She fixed it.
Like what?
She didn't like me right off the bat. She didn't like me.
Really?
So she fixed it so that, and she had invested in this movie.
Right.
So she fixed it so that I wouldn't, in all of our scenes together,
right.
She had it shot so that they could cut me out.
You're kidding.
And they did.
They cut you out.
They cut me out. In the movie, at the credits, it says, you know, starring Robert Stack, Polly Bergen, and Diane McBain.
Uh-huh.
And you hardly ever see
me.
See
you in the film. She cut you out.
She cut me out.
Was she really that a bitch to do that?
She was awful.
Really?
Yeah.
I interviewed her daughter, you know.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, Christina.
And she sent her, she would never do her offstage scenes with me. She'd always send her dialogue guy in and to work with me instead of... Uh-huh. I never did that to another actor. Never. I don't care if I had to stay until midnight. I would never do that to another actor.
Uh-huh.
But she did.
So you're going to put that in your book about Miss Crawford,
yes,
huh? You got a lot
yes.
of dirt about. What has been the hardest for Diane McBain? What has been the hardest?
Hardest? You mean
the
as an actress?
The thing in showbiz as an actress, yeah. What has been the hardest for you?
Oh, gosh. I think the transition from studio to independent.
Like, give me an example.
Well, okay, it was at the end of the studio system, and so after about 4.5 years of my contract, they dismantled the system totally.
Right, right.
And I was totally unprepared. Most of everybody in my generation were totally unprepared
right,
for this. They
right.
were all studio actors, and they had no idea what to do, and I didn't either. And it was up to me to choose scripts. You know, now it's an automatic thing. You learn how to, decide what scripts are good for you and what I didn't know.
But now you're writing, Diane.
I'm writing. Now
I know. You write, you produce. Mm-hmm. You do. And matter of fact, you write for a newspaper, right?
I have in the past.
Yes.
But, I mean, now I'm writing screenplays.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I love to write screenplays. It's great fun.
Uh-huh. So you want to produce your own things?
Well, yeah, sure.
See, from a little girl from Glendale becoming an actress in Glendale. So you learned a lot from Warners.
Oh, yeah.
And Miss Joan Crawford.
And Miss Crawford, yes.
What has been the biggest lesson?
Well, like I'm saying, you know, that was it. It was having to learn how to run a business.
Uh-huh.
Because as an independent actress, you have to run your own business. You have to learn how to choose scripts. You have to know how to pick the right PR people. You have to know how to do a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know how to do that. So that was a big lesson.
You did a movie called Mary Mary with Barry Sullivan, Barry Nelson. Yes, that was a good movie.
Debbie Reynolds. Yes.
Sweet movie.
Yeah, it was a
You've
Broadway.
You've done some sweet movies. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, sweet movies.
Yeah, but I was sort of a bitchy
Another
girl
bitch.
In there.
Another
yeah.
bitchy girl.
Yeah.
Mary Mary. how many movies have you done? A lot of other... The Other Woman.
The Other You've
Woman. Always played The Other Woman.
Other Woman, always.
Why is that, Diane? Do you think?
I don't know.
They always typecast you like that.
I could never understand it, and I never felt on the inside the way they were casting me on the outside.
Uh-huh.
Didn't relate at all.
Movie I saw was I Sailed to Tahiti. Tell me about that
one. Yeah, that was another bitchy role.
I said, who was in that?
I was the heavy in that.
Yeah,
that was Gardner McKay.
Gardner McKay, yeah.
Yeah, and a bunch of girls.
A lot of girls. Did you go to Tahiti, or was this filmed here?
No, we went to Hawaii.
Oh, you do? Uh-huh.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
And we filmed on sailboats.
Tell me about Surfside 6 with Troy on that. You stayed in Hawaii working on
that. No, we didn't do that in Hawaii. That was Florida.
Oh, was it Florida?
That was Miami Beach.
Oh, yeah, that's right,
yeah.
Surfside 6, yeah.
And we just went down there a couple of weeks out of the year to do background shots, and then we came up here, and they built the whole set on a stage, you know.
Uh-huh.
In those days, they did things on the stage. They didn't go out to location so much.
You did a good movie called Claudel
English.
English. Tell me about that.
That's my favorite, actually, because I played the title role.
Right.
And I was chosen, you know, out of a group of pretty notable people, and...
Who wrote that?
Erskine Caldwell was the...
Tobacco Road guy.
Yeah, he wrote the novel, and it was adapted.
You have the clip.
You do?
Yeah, I'm going to show it right now.
Oh, good.
It's a clip from this Claudel English. Let's show it.
Yeah, okay. Connie Ford was in that.
Oh, Connie.
I got some good news for you. I'll tell it to you if you promise you won't get mad.
I never get mad at good news, Mama.
I had a talk with ST a little bit ago. He's not mad at you anymore. He's coming over to take you out tonight.
That's just fine. I won't be here.
Now, Claudel.
Mama, I'm sorry. I just won't be here.
Claudel, this is your last chance. Take it. You got that man half crazy. I don't understand it myself. He knows you've been running around with every boy in the county. But he wants you so bad he's half crazy. He's ready to drive you over to the Justice of the Peace and marry you tonight.
Mama, for the last time. I don't want to have anything to do with that fat old fool. Stevie, now.
Goodbye. Claudel.
Goodbye, Mama.
Do you have any... That's a good clip.
Yeah.
Do you have any regrets at all?
Lots.
About the system and about Hollywood. You know, Hollywood has changed, Diane.
Oh, tremendously.
Hollywood has changed. I walk down Hollywood Boulevard, I see the stars' names on that street. It was never really beautiful. You know, Hollywood Boulevard was never... But it's scummy today.
It really is, isn't it?
It is really the worst today.
Yeah.
You know, how do you feel about that, the change of Hollywood?
Well, I see it more as a change in style. When I was doing most of my acting, you went to the studio, it was like a family. And everybody was together, and we all worked together. And it was, you felt so intimate and great about the people you were working with.
Right.
And after the movie was over, you stayed in touch, and you were friends. And now, golly, you work on a movie, and you never see anybody again after that.
That's it, yeah.
Yeah, it's like... You know, you don't see Troy passing in the night.
You don't see Troy or Connie Stevens or any unless you go to parties and bump into them.
Once in a while. Uh-huh. Long while.
Is Diane McBain a nightclub that, you know, we don't have nightclubs really in Hollywood anymore. But
no,
you don't
I
go
was
to
never
restaurant?
An entertainer in
no?
that sense, no.
You just like to be
actress.
Quiet here in Hollywood? Just
I am very quiet.
Because Hollywood is actually like punching a clock and going to work. Mm-hmm. At 5 in the morning and mm-hmm. coming home at 6.
Yeah.
And that's
at
it.
Night, yeah. And I mean, you go to bed.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I'm too old to uh-huh. be messing around after uh-huh. working all day and have to get up early in
theater,
the morning.
Theater, the children's theater. You've done a lot of theater. Now, tell me about the children's theater. Diane McBain is connected with the children's theater.
Yeah.
Tell me about it.
Well, you know, I love kids. And I've done a lot of a variety of programs for a while. I was producing some children's theater throughout the schools throughout Southern California.
Right.
And right now, I'm working with a group, California Youth Theater and Blue Star, and we're putting on an event February the 19th.
Right.
I got my hat.
This is a benefit event.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
See, okay. California Youth Theater.
Youth Theater.
Yes. And we train at-risk youth in the arts and crafts
right.
of film and theater.
Uh-huh.
And right now we're putting on an event February the 19th at Paramount Studios.
At Paramount Studios.
Yeah, it's Sunday afternoon between the hours of 1
for kids,
and 5.
The kids are good?
It's for the kids. They are going to paint T-shirts. Uh-huh. The theme is nonviolence. You know, we want
right.
to take violence out of society, put art in, you know.
So Diane's very concerned about things like that, what's happening
there. Very, very much.
Go ahead. I
like
this.
I do a lot of work on behalf of a lot of different things. Mm-hmm. I do work for the homeless, and I do work for children. And
Diane, and also you help the AIDS tell me about that.
Well, for a while, I was delivering food to
AIDS.
Yeah.
You mean Angel Food?
Yeah, Project Angel
Project
Food.
Angel Food.
I was one of the first deliverers for
really?
Project Angel
oh,
Food.
Really? Oh, Diane, really?
When they initiated the program, we cleaned the kitchen and got it all going.
Uh-huh.
We were the first people to deliver food for people with uh-huh. AIDS.
Mm-hmm. You're very concerned what's happening out there in the world, then, that Diane McBain is not. You're
yeah.
very spiritual, aren't you?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, mm-hmm.
You work with churches and stuff like that?
I do. I'm associated with All Saints Episcopal Church in Beverly Hills
mm-hmm.
and do a lot of ministry there.
So you like to work with kids?
I love kids. They're great. I have a son, you know.
That's right. You've been married.
Yeah, I've been, well.
You have,
how many,
you have one, just one child?
One
child?
One child.
Uh-huh.
Which,
that's
one regret, is that I didn't have more. I wish
you
I'd
did
had
wanted
maybe
a family.
Six
you did
or
wanted
seven
a family.
Kids. I did want that.
I see.
I just never
so you do have a little regrets
it.
About
I do.
A little
yeah.
back going back that you yeah. should have got married and got a family together.
Yeah,
huh?
I should have done that earlier. I mm-hmm. got married.
How did you
later.
Meet your husband?
Through a spiritual group. No.
Oh, spiritual.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
yeah, yeah. We were Buddhists together. I'm
Are
not
you
a Buddhist anymore, but I was then.
Explain me about Buddhism. What
explain
do you
explain you?
Yeah, just a little about Buddhism. That's meditation and all that, or
yes, yes. It's very different. It's a very different. It's more mind and a control and that sort of thing, rather than spiritual. You can't explain a little about Buddhism and Christianity. I mean, that's a whole.
Uh-huh. Looking back, Diane, in your life right now,
you
have one boy.
Mm-hmm.
You have a man in your life right now?
Yeah.
You do have.
Uh-huh.
So you're going to get married again, do you think?
Well, I don't know about marriage, but, you know, uh-huh. we're together.
You're a very beautiful lady.
Thank you.
And it's very nice seeing you. Tell me about your theater, the Glass Menagerie. I love that. Where did you do that?
I did that up in Monterey. They had this wonderful theater up there.
Uh-huh.
And we did the first play. It's gone now,
right.
unfortunately. But I played Amanda, and which was a wonderful experience.
That's a great one.
Yeah.
That's a tough play.
That's a very tough play.
Tennessee and Williams.
Amanda's role is the most difficult.
It's a difficult,
thing.
Yeah.
Very,
yeah.
Very difficult.
Star Spangled Girls.
Oh, yeah.
Tell
well,
me about that. That's fun.
Well,
that's,
I did
that's
that in New York. We
have, uh-huh. Tell me, where'd you, what theater
I
was
did that?
That
with Eddie Burns. You remember Eddie Burns?
Of course, Kooky.
Kooky Burns.
Sunset Strip.
We did a tour with that.
God, you and traveled. Eddie Burns and Troy Donahue. This is all that That's the era of the 60s.
That's the era of the 60s.
That's right. That's right. That's right. Eddie Burns, they're all AA now. Troy, Eddie Burns.
Well, Eddie isn't AA, I don't think.
Yes, he is.
He's in a program, but not AA.
Oh, well, programs. They're all programs. in a program. They're all doing fine.
Programs are great. I'm in a program. I won't tell you which one. I believe in the program. I think, for instance, that the homeless situation could be helped tremendously with a program for homeless people. You know, I mean,
what do you mean by having a homeless program?
Yeah, Homeless Anonymous.
Right.
Because I think it's a disease. It's something that it's not like you choose it. Nobody chooses their particular.
But you believe some of them could go to work, Diane?
Absolutely.
You've met a lot of these homeless.
But they have to. But it's like a whole mindset that they have to work on and get straightened out, and a spiritual thing going on.
What's your philosophy in life? Because you like philosophers, and you like what is your philosophy in life?
Well,
I know
you ask these profound questions, and ask me, you want a one sentence answer.
I know.
It's kind of amazing.
Excuse me.
I just believe that we have an obligation.
Right.
To ourselves, to God, and to our community, to behave properly, and to do what is right, and I just believe in that kind of responsibility. And if I have to get into a program in order to do what's right, then that's a good thing.
So you think we should help the homeless more so than let them get work?
Helping the homeless. We have a tendency to overhelp.
Giving dollars here and there, and every time, hey, buddy, can you spare a dime
that's
and all
not
that?
Good. That's
no.
Not good. That creates a dependency relationship, and that's not a good thing.
Well, the president's trying to do that right now. The president of America, and they're trying to cut people off of welfare and let them go back to work, create jobs.
Well, that's all very nice. It's a nice thing to say, but you know what?
What?
You have to have jobs first so that these people can go back to work. That's number one. And then you have to help them in here and in here. You can't just say, well, you got to get off the dole, go to work, and expect people to jump up and do this. Uh-huh. They're not going to do it.
Did you ever speak to the homeless and talk to them and ask them about certain things about themselves?
Sure. I've had long conversations with homeless people. They're wonderful people.
Uh-huh.
They have learned that they can survive without the system.
Right.
And once you learn that, once you know that you can survive without the system, it's real hard to go back.